Thank you so much. First, I'd like to thank the organizers of this conference for the invitation and for the opportunity to speak at such a wonderful place. Thank you so much. So my talk is devoted to a certain symbolic dynamical system, which is called Weshek automorphism. It can be regarded as a symbolic analog for many dynamical systems of parabolic type, for example, for interval exchange maps and translation flows, which we'll discuss a little bit later. But let me start with the definitions. So I consider a graph gamma with two m vertices that I arranged in two levels. There are m vertices on the top level and m vertices at the bottom. Here it is. All edges go from the top level to the bottom one, and we assume that for each vertex from the top level there exists an outcoming edge, as well as, and for the vertex from the bottom level there exists an incoming one. And we also permit the multiple edges. So this graph gamma can be represented by the incidence matrix. That is, we enumerate the edges at the top and in the bottom, and we just count the number of edges that start from I and in G. Let me now consider a sequence of such graphs, gamma n. I put graph gamma n plus 1 over the graph gamma n. And consider the graded graph, which is the union of these graphs gamma n. I consider the set of all paths in this big graded graph. The set I'll call the Markov compactum. So each point in the Markov compactum is just the sequence of edges. So on this set of paths, we have an equivalence relation. We say that two paths are equivalent if there exists a level such that these two paths are the same starting this level and above. And let us denote gamma infinity plus the equivalence class of a path X. So it is drawn like that. So these equivalence classes form the vertical foliation. The name vertical, I won't explain now why it's called so, but this is just a foliation that we defined in this way. In the similar way, we can define the horizontal foliation, which is if we identify the paths that are the same below. So it is a very nice structure, but I want some dynamics in it. So to provide some dynamics, I first order the paths. I provide an ordering on the set of all the paths. So I start with the ordering on each vertex V. I start with an ordering for the set of all edges that go out from every vertex V. And thus, I obtain a linear ordering on the set of all paths in this tails set. Now I want to provide some dynamics on this. I consider a Markov compactum that corresponds to the graph which is infinite from one side, which is the union of graphs gamma 1, gamma 2, and so on. Since I have the ordering, I define a natural map which switches the path X, it's not the color, to the path Tx, which is its successor with respect to this ordering on the set of edges. So this map is called the Weshek automorphism. Weshek automorphisms are the symbolic model for instance, for internal exchange maps. So let me consider a surface and a flow in it. I have already partitioned my surface into the union of the rectangles, like that. Now I want enter, well, and I consider the direction of flow. The first atom map of this flow is the internal exchange map that permutes the intervals here. So I want to identify the paths in this big graph with the points on the interval. So there is a natural map on this surfaces, which is called which induction. Informally, it cuts off the part of the rightmost rectangle and puts it somewhere above. So so how do we give the correspondence between the paths and the points on the interval? We say that two paths are equivalent with respect to the relation. If after the n iterations of such of this Razievich induction, we fall into the same rectangle. For example, points t and tx are equivalent. Well, each leaf in this graph thus corresponds to the orbit of y under the, and he is, it is x, well, okay, and of y under the interval exchange map. Clear? That's all. Well, okay. So here's the picture how to describe, how to build one level of this graph. After applying the one step of the Razievich induction. So, but naturally, if we want to encode the orbits of the flow on the surface, we want to have some suspension structure on our Markov compactum. For this purpose, we consider a B-infinite Markov compactum, that is the Markov compactum that corresponds to the graph that is infinite from both sides. In this case, the Taylor equivalence classes are not discrete, so we do not have any successors. We do not have Vivarsky automorphism. But we can define a flow on the foliation formed by these sets. Very informally, you switch the arrows very far below, and then high, on high and higher levels. And so this is how you obtain the flow. There is another example of it. You switch from the number 0.23 to 0.24. When you continuously write, and so the you can think of the levels of this graph as of the digits, and switching the arrows is just switching the digits while going to the number 24. So, but more formally, the such a symbolic flow is defined as follows. We move along the leaves of these foliations with a unit speed. How to define the unit speed? One has to provide a set of Lebesgue measure. Well, more geometrically, this leaf corresponds to the orbit of the flow in this surface. How to define the positive measure given a sequence of incidence matrices of these graphs? We shall assume that we assume for a while, but then we'll show that for a typical Markov compactum, this assumption holds, that there exists a sequence of vectors with positive coordinates such that such that they have such an equivalence property. And the first property, the second property can be described as follows, that for small arcs of the flow, the measure is exponentially decaying. So how, given this sequence of vectors, we can define a measure. So for any vertex, I consider a canonically chosen path that goes through this vertex. And I set the measure on the set of all paths that coincide with this path, Zim, since this level n. Or more geometrically, you define measure on the set of this arc that are the sides of the rectangles of this Markovian partition. Okay, so this is how we define the measure, and indeed, if the number of edges grows sub-exponentially as n goes to infinity, we can extend this measure to any arc of the flow. So, well, thus we obtain the flow, which can be viewed as a suspension flow over the vertical automorphism. Namely, we restrict ourselves onto the subgraph, which is obtained by deleting all the negative subgraphs. And actually, the resultant map is just the first resultant map is just switching the arrows, which is the Weschek automorphism. Okay. Well, now we want to obtain the answers for the following questions: whether the flow HT is ergodic with respect to the measure which it preserves. Preserves the product of the Lebesgue measures on the stable and, not stable, but vertical and horizontal foliation. And there are two other questions. Precise asymptotics, do we know the precise asymptotics of the ergodic integral? And last question, when this integral is uniformly bounded in x and t. Well, to give an answer to this question, I provide, following the works of Alexander Bufetov, the construction of finitely additive measures. You might have heard of it if you attended to Professor Klemenko's lectures. So these are the same measures as the Lebesgue measure that we defined before, but we refuse from the property of the positivity of these measures. Actually, these measures are the same. They are given by sequence of, it doesn't work, well, of these equivalence matrices. Well, so by the definition, finitely additive measures are the subspace in Rm, where M is the number of vertices at each level. Just by the definition that we identified these measures with the vectors with such coordinates. So, but we can say something more. Well, to say something more, I want to obtain the renormalization map. Namely, it is just the topological Markov shift. How does it act on the Markov capacitum X? it just pulls it down for one level. So the shift of the Markov compactum. So the end subgraph of the shifted Markov compactum is the m plus ones of the previous. Well, so this map admits a sort of a cycle that is just the product of these incidence matrices. Well, these subgraphs, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, and so on. So, let us provide some additional assumptions on these products of matrices. Namely, I assume that there exists an ergodic shift invariant probability measure on the set of all Markov compacta, such that with the positive probability there exists a subgraph gamma 0 with incidence matrix that has all the positive coordinates, together with the properties of invertibility and the integrability of this cocycle, we realize that we can apply the oscillators theorem to this cocycle. Namely, we can decompose the space Rm, where the product of matrices acts, into the sum of the stable and the unstable and the central stable subspace, where the growth of vectors in ECS, the central stable subspace, is at most sub-exponential. And the growth of the expanding vectors is given precisely. So, thus, we can identify the set of finite related measures with the unstable subspace of this cocycle. Why does it hold? Because we have said by the definition that it decays exponentially for small arcs. Thus we obtain such an identification. So one can consider the measures on the transversal filiation, and these spaces are isomorphic, because the space B minus is isomorphic to the unstable subspace of the transposed cocycle. Well, so we are almost ready to write a statement about the precise asymptotics of this integral. Well, for this purpose, let me consider a functional, which is the product of the positive measure on the vertical filiation and an arbitrary finitely added measure on the horizontal filiation. One second. Well, these functionals are invariant under the action of the flow, and due to the pairing between the measures on two filiations, we can obtain the following asymptotics of the ergodic integral for Lipschitz functions. So, what is the first term in this decomposition? It is just the positive Lebesgue measure. So we get the ergodic theorem. So the answer to this question for a typical Markov compactor is positive. So it's ergodic. Moreover, we can give a precise asymptotic of this integral. Okay, but what about the third question? Well, the third question. Well, we want our integrals to be uniformly bounded. Of course, if all finitely additive measures are zero for our Markov compactum, on the contrary, if there are no zero, we cannot hope for this. Okay, let us assume that all finite relative matters are zero. This is equivalent to the statement that these distributions are equal to zero. How to kill this term times epsilon? So we must smoothen somehow our function f, we consider the space of continuous functions on x that have ellipsis derivative along the horizontal filiation. You will ask me, how is it possible that you can differentiate my function in this symbolic space? But I can say that we consider the derivative as just the limit, and this is precisely defined. The argument is that we differentiate over the along the foliation, and along the foliation, the derivative can be defined. Well, so given these two assumptions, we can state that these integrals are uniformly bounded. Well, due to Gottschalk-Kant theorem, the previous result implies that if we consider such an equation, then it has a bounded solution. So what does this cohomological equation mean? You can ask yourself, what suspension flows are equivalent to each other? Well, the suspension flows are, when you answer this question, you should write this equation. And how much I have? 6 minutes, yes? Well, I must go to the proof. Well, for the proof, I'll switch to the geometric language, if you won't mind. So this theorem could be reformulated in terms of translation flows and interval exchange maps. And before it was this type of theorem was proved for these dynamical systems by Mamiya-Sayakos and Forney. So what do we do? We draw an arc of the flow. We decompose it into the union of arcs that are the arcs of the rectangles of this partition, arcs of the type gamma n plus, whatever it means. So, and we can think of this arc as the sum of, as the union of two parts, the small part and the big part. For the small part, the geometric we get a geometric series because the number of edges and thus the rectangles grows sub-exponentially, while their heights or while these lengths decay exponentially. So we get a geometric series. The problem is to prove that the integral along this long Markovian arc is uniformly bounded. So the main argument is that we can approximate the integral over this long arc gamma.
F d mu plus gamma.
By the finitely additive measure on the arc gamma. You can do it uniformly. So why it is, since we can, if we can do that, assuming that all the distributions are zero, we just arrived at the statement of the theorem. But why can we do that? I'll give just two claims for that, and then we will end. Everyone will be happy. Okay, so the first claim is the following. Let us consider a long Markov rectangle. And I consider two closed arcs, gamma n and gamma n prime. So it turns out that under our assumptions, the difference between two integrals along these arcs decays exponentially, since n is the number of steps of Radziwicz induction. It decays exponentially. Thus, in the similar way that we did for the definition of finitely additive measures, I just for every Markov rectangle in this series of partitions, I just choose one of the arcs and define a vector whose coordinate is just the integral along this arc. This sequence of vectors is not a covariant, but it is almost a covariant in the sense that the difference, the norm of this difference, decays exponentially. And here the final claim comes that if we have such a sequence of vectors, then we can choose the one from the unstable subspace of the cocycle, which is the product of matrices, such that we can approximate the sequence uniformly. So this is rather technical lemma. He is sort of a proof, but I think I don't have much time to discuss it. So thank you so much.